than any anime. His power is greater, for he has created everything. Hallelujah, Jesus. Worship your name, God. so good to me. For I took a breath, you breathed your life in me.
Welcome, a pleasant good morning, a blessed good morning to you, your families, you, our viewers, our faithful viewers, and our listeners. We greet you this morning in the powerful name of the Lord Jesus Christ on this blessed Sunday morning, this first Sunday morning of the month of May. And I tell you, time is moving by so quickly. And so we welcome you, and we hope that you're enjoying, you know, this ministry, and you're receiving. We really believe that God wants to minister into your life and speak to you and encourage you in more than one ways. I want to also encourage you, before I get into the word this morning, to get your families together. And today, customarily in our church, every first Sunday, we normally have Holy Communion. And so I just want to put you on the alert after we minister the word and we pray. We want to share communion together. And so if you can get your cricks or your crackers, your bread, your grape juice, you know, have it on hand. While we minister, and so that we would be happy if you can join us today to follow this institution of the Lord Jesus Christ. This morning we want to go to the book of John, the Gospel of St. John, chapter 5, verses 1 to 9. I want to entitle today's message, A Divine Encounter. A Divine Encounter. And so I read from John's Gospel, chapter 5, verse 1. It says, "And this, after this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there is in Jerusalem by the Sheep Gate a pool, which is called in Hebrew Bethesda, having five porches. In these lay a great multitude of sick people, blind, lame, paralyzed, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel of the Lord went down at a certain time into the pool and stirred up the water. Then whoever stepped in first, after the stirring of the water, was made well of whatever disease he had. Now a certain man was there who had an infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he had already been in that condition a long time, he said to him, 'Do you want to be made well?' The sick man answered him, 'Sir, I have no man to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up. But while I am coming, another steps down before me.' Jesus said to him, 'Rise, take up your bed and walk.' And immediately the man was made well, took up his bed and walked. And that day was the Sabbath." This morning I want to share with you for a few minutes on a divine encounter. A divine encounter. Let's pray and ask God's blessing on his word and this ministry. Father, we thank you for today. We declare that this is the day you have made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the opportunity to share truth. And we thank you, Father, for the blessed opportunity to hear your voice. We pray that you will speak to us today. And we thank you for ears to hear, eyes to see, and hearts to understand. So we say, "Speak, Lord, for your servants hear it." And we declare we shall never be the same again. In Jesus' name with thanksgiving. Amen and amen and amen. A divine encounter. A divine encounter. I feel impressed of the Lord today to address and to speak and to encourage folks who feel forgotten, folks who feel forsaken, passed up or passed by or overtaken in life by others for acknowledgement, for promotion, for blessing, for miracles, etc. Maybe you're looking today and maybe you feel that you're forgotten. You've been forgotten by God. You've been overlooked or bypassed by friends, families, your siblings, your parents, your colleagues, your employers. Maybe you've been on standby. You've been overlooked, as it were, for a promotion on your job, a raise in your salary, you know, a breakthrough, a miracle, a healing in your body, something you've been praying about, something you've been trusting God for, something you've been dreaming about. It just seems to have been shattered, and others seem to be as though they're getting their blessings, and others seem to be bypassing you and have already landed at their own home and maybe their own car, or maybe you're single and hoping to get married, and others, your friends or your siblings, they are bypassing you and they're getting married and you're still single, and there are different things happening in your life and you feel forgotten this morning. I want to speak and encourage those of you who feel like that this morning, because there is this man in this text in John chapter 5 who had an encounter with Jesus. And I'm saying that in the midst of crisis, he faced a crisis. He found himself in a difficult situation. He was being overlooked. He was being bypassed, overtaken, as we would see in a while. But his day came, his season came, his time came, and in the midst of his crisis, sometimes to turn a crisis around, to turn a situation around, a difficult circumstance in your life, sometimes we need a divine encounter. Even in the midst of this COVID-19 crisis and other crises that you might be facing, and when all else has failed and there's uncertainty and no one seems to know what to do or what is going to happen, I want to submit to you today what we need is a divine encounter. We need God to intervene. We need God to get involved. We need a spiritual experience, as it were, an encounter of faith, an encounter with the supernatural, an encounter with the omnipotent God. And so this man, the scripture doesn't reveal much about him. It doesn't reveal how it happened with regards to his illness, whether it was by accident or whether it was by birth. But this man that the Bible talks about, that Jesus encountered, that encountered Jesus, was paralyzed, as it were, for 38 years. He had never stood on his own two feet for 38 years. I don't know for certain if he would be coming to this pool for 38 years, but he was in this condition, in a paralysis, as it were, for 38 years. This man's condition appeared incurable, impossible, and unsolvable, as it were. And due to his paralysis, he would never be the first to get into this pool called Bethesda after it had been troubled, as it were, by an angel. Others would always overtake him and get into the pool first and receive their healing and receive their miracle. He had no one to help him. And it doesn't matter how long or how bad this morning your situation is, it is not over until God says it's over. This man, time came, his season came, 38 years is a long time. And I want to say it's never too late for God to make your impossible possible. It's never too late for God to make your unsolvable situation and circumstances solvable by his divine power and by a divine encounter. If you are breathing this morning, if you're alive, I want to declare to you that there is hope. And God Almighty is not finished with you. This man might have felt that maybe God was finished with him. Others were finished with him. Society was finished with him, as it were, because he had been in this situation for so long. He suffered from paralysis, as it were. And maybe you feel disabled this morning. Maybe you feel a paralysis in your life. Maybe emotionally you feel disabled because of past or present abuses in your life. Things have been said, negative things have been spoken, and you feel disabled and traumatized emotionally. Maybe you suffer from a paralysis of fear, a paralysis of doubt. Maybe there's some kind of paralysis in your life. Maybe it's a financial paralysis. Maybe it's a spiritual paralysis, an emotional. Maybe your heart is broken due to a breakup in a relationship or some situation that may have caused you some type of paralysis. This man was physically paralyzed, and you might be experiencing some kind of paralysis. And so the Bible tells us that he, for 38 years, I'm not too sure, but he found himself by this pool in Jerusalem, by the Sheep Gate, and that pool was called Bethesda. And so the Bible tells us that the Sheep Gate, it was by the Sheep Gate because the shepherds would lead or drive their sheep through this gate, this particular gate, and over on the right side of that pool would be this pool called Bethesda, as it were. And the Bible tells us that this man found himself at the pool of Bethesda. Now, Bethesda in the Hebrew means house of mercy. And this pool was a two-pool complex. It was approximately 20 feet deep and 150 feet long by 300 feet wide. And the sheep, it was a two-complex type of pool. The sheep washed on one end of the pool and people bathed on the other end, or they would have swam, as the case may be, on the other end. And this pool was fed by an underground spring, and when that spring overflowed, it would bubble from beneath, causing a disturbance in the waters above. However, there was a superstition in that day that grew around this particular pool, where some or many believed that the waters were stirred by an angel, and at that first stir, anyone who would enter into that water, after it was stirred by the angel, would be healed or cured of their disease. It is said that it was a superstition because history and the record and the research showed there was actually a spring that caused this water to bubble. And around this pool, many folks, the Bible says, would gather this pool. And the Bible says in verse 2, a great multitude of sick people, blind, lame, paralyzed. And this looked like a hospital without walls, as it were, naming the characteristics of the people. And so this man was in this situation. He might have felt forgotten. He might have felt overtaken, overpassed, because the situation was real. It seemed hopeless, as it were. But on this particular day, the Bible tells us that Jesus arrived in Jerusalem, and he was apparently alone. There is no mention made of his disciples. Probably they were with him, but not at that particular point. And he found his way somehow in his mind, in his wisdom. He wanted to go, and he found his way to this famous pool. And so this man, his day came, his time came. And I want to declare to you this morning that your time has come, your day has come, your season has come. God delays and not his denial. And I want to be clear and believe that you will experience and have in your crisis a divine encounter. And observe three things that the Lord Jesus did that God will do for you when we have a divine encounter. When you have a divine encounter, the first thing I observe is that Jesus recognized the man. Jesus recognized the man. The Bible says in verse 6 that when Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he already had been in that condition a long time. Now, there was a great multitude of people on that particular day. Jesus could have gone to any person in that place, yet for his own reasons, he went to this man. He picked this man. He chose this man. Not that he favored this man above others, not that he didn't care about the others, but for some particular reason, known to the Lord Jesus in his divine wisdom and knowledge, he recognized this man. He saw this man. The Bible says he knew he had already been there. I want to say to you that for a divine encounter, God recognized recognizes you. Jesus knows you. God knows He's the omnipotent. And so Jesus knew this man's situation without having been told it by this man or anybody else, because He's God and He's all-knowing. 38 years, this man had been paralyzed and unable to walk. And perhaps all of that time, he was being brought to this pool to wait with hope, an intention of some kind of miracle. I want to declare to you today that Jesus recognizes you. He knows you. He knows your situation. He knows exactly where you are. You may feel forgotten. You may feel overpassed, overtaken as it were. But I want to let you know that Jesus recognized this man. Even though he went through this difficulty for 38 years with hope, Jesus recognized him. Jesus knew him perfectly. And I want you to know, in case if you feel that God don't know and God don't care in your crisis, in your difficulties, in your paralysis, that Jesus knows you perfectly. He knows everything about you inside out. All that you have ever felt, thought, or done, the Lord Jesus. The Bible says, and when he saw him lying there, for divine encounter to take place, we must believe and we must know that God knows us, that he recognizes us. He sees us exactly where we are. And because he made us and he created us in his image and likeness, he knows things about us that other people may not know. In Psalms 139 verses 2, to 4, the psalmist writing and confirming that God recognizes and God knows us. He says, you know my sitting down and my rising up. You understand my thought afar off. You comprehend my path and my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways. The psalmist confirmed that God knew his sitting down, his rising up, his thoughts even afar off, even before you even think it. God knew his thoughts. God comprehended his path and his lying down, and God was acquainted. I want you to know that when divine encounter is about to take place and the miracle breakthrough is about to take place, you need to know that God's eyes is upon you. He's looking at you. He knew even before you were born. You were chosen even before the world began. The Bible says in the book of Jeremiah chapter 1 and verse 5, talking about that great prophet Jeremiah, God speak. He says, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I sanctified you. I ordained you a prophet to the nation. Speaking of God's foreknowledge, speaking of God's knowledge of Jeremiah, the psalmist, and even this man, and even you and I today, just as the Lord Jesus was standing at that pool at Bethesda on that particular day, among all those people, he picked this man out of the crowd. The Lord Jesus Christ is picking you out of the crowd today. He is choosing you wherever you may be, whatever nation, whatever country, whatever city or location you are in. God sees and he knows exactly where you are. He is standing in that place beside you, just like he was standing next to this man who had the paralysis. After all, we have done nothing to deserve God's love. We have done nothing to earn our salvation for those who have been born again and receive God's salvation. We have done nothing even to make God notice us, because we are sinners, we are rebels. But yet God in his love and in his mercy, he loves us, he knows us, hallelujah. And we want to give him praise and thanks that this place, Bethesda, is called the house of mercy. And here the Lord Jesus met this man at the pool of Bethesda, the house of mercy. The Lord Jesus, who's the merciful one, the compassionate one, met this man and he recognize him. I want to declare to you, when divine encounter is about to take place, know that God's eyes is upon you, and he knows you, and he feels your pain, he sees your situation, he sees your paralysis. And the Bible says, not only did Jesus recognize this man, and we know that God knows, but secondly and quickly, Jesus not only knew about this man and his situation, but Jesus reached out to the man. Jesus reached out to the man. Out of everybody, Jesus saw him. Jesus recognized him. Out of everybody in the multitude, Jesus asked him in verse 6, do you want to get well? Do you want to get well? In other words, do you want to be helped? Do you want to change, as it were? The Lord Jesus asked him. And it would have been interesting, even in my mind, looking at it, looking at this man. He's paralyzed. He can't walk. He has a difficult situation. Why would the Lord Jesus ask this man, do you want to get well? And I believe there's a few reasons why Jesus reached out to this man with this question, do you want to get well? I believe, firstly, it was for Jesus to communicate to this man as a stranger to him that Jesus cares and he has compassion. Jesus cares. I believe he asks, and we ask people, how are you? How are you today? How are you doing? And sometimes we ask it rhetorically, as it were. Sometimes we just ask it as a cliche in passing. But when Jesus asks a question, it's because he's thinking about you. It's because he cares. And not only does he know, but what does he know? He wants to do something. He wants to reach out. And so he reached out to this man, I believe, because he cares. In 1 Peter 5, 7, it says, casting all your care upon him, for he cares for you. I want to declare to you tonight, today, that the Lord Jesus cares for you. I believe that reveals that Jesus moved towards me. Jesus went to Jerusalem. He could have gone anywhere. He could have gone to a nice restaurant. He could have gone to the palace. He could have gone even to the synagogue, as it were. But he chose to go in a place where people had great need. He chose to go in a place where people were broken, where they were hopeless, where they were helpless. The Bible says they were sick and they were lame and they were paralyzed. Notice where Jesus went. And I believe the reason why he asked that question, I believe is to reveal to us that the Lord Jesus cares. I want to declare to you, the Lord Jesus cares for you and he cares for me this morning. He looks beyond our faults and our failures and he cares for us in spite of our sins, in spite of our past, in spite of our mistakes. He still reaches out to us. Just as he reached out to this man in his hopeless situation, he's reaching out to us today. Why did the Lord ask this man this question in reaching out to him? I believe it was because the Lord Jesus wanted to stimulate and encourage this man's faith. He might have felt hopeless. He might probably wanted to give up. Maybe his faith was weak, but by Jesus asking, do you want to get well? As he reached out to him, it might have been to stimulate. I believe the Lord Jesus Christ, through this word today, maybe through the COVID-19, through the crisis you are facing, I believe the Lord Jesus is speaking to you because he wants to stimulate your faith. He wants to encourage your faith, to put your confidence and your trust in Almighty God. I believe the Lord Jesus reached out to this man with this question, do you want to get well? Was to stir in him a greater desire for being healed, a greater desire for receiving hope and a miracle. And sometimes the Lord Jesus, amen, stirs our desires as he works through situations and circumstances. And he says, do you want to get well? I believe was to stir this man's desire to get well, to get that miracle. I believe also that Jesus, in asking this man, do you want to get well, was to also help this man to affirm and to recognize his need. His need, he identified to the Lord Jesus in verse 7, sir, I have no man to put me into the pool. I believe the reason why Jesus reached out to this man was to bring him to a place to stir his faith, reveal that he cares. Are you with me? To stir desire in this man for the miracle, to help him to identify his need. But I also believe that one of the reasons why Jesus asked this man, do you want to get well, is because you cannot help someone who doesn't want to get help. We might assume that this man in the situation that he was in would have wanted a miracle and wanted to be healed. But there are some folks, sometimes you feel that they want to be helped, but you cannot help someone who doesn't want to be helped. And Jesus wanted to ensure that he identified his need and he truly wanted to be helped. Jesus says to him, do you really want to be changed? Do you really want to be well? And so sometimes in our innermost hearts, we are well content. There are some folks who are well content to stay as we are, and there can be no change for persons who do not want to be helped. He wanted to confirm to this man that he wanted to be helped. Not everybody wants to be well. Not everybody wants help, because some people enjoy being pitied or dependent on others. But the Lord Jesus, in asking this man, do you want to be well, was to encourage desire, help him to recognize his need for help, let him know that Jesus cares, and to stimulate this man's faith. After Jesus recognized this man, reached out to him with this question, the Lord Jesus restored the man. Thirdly, Jesus not only recognized the man, he not only reached out to the man, but he restored the man. In verse 8, the Bible says, rise. Jesus speaking to him, he says, rise, take up your bed and walk. Wow, I tell you, just that one word of the Lord Jesus, immediately the Bible says the man was healed. He took up his bed and he walked. When Jesus speak, I want to declare to you that disease and miracles and bones obey. When Jesus speak, blind eye open, the deaf ears pop open. Glory to God. The lame walk, the dead are risen back to life by the powers of the words of the Lord Jesus. And when Jesus speaks, he speaks there as God. He speaks in his own name, not in another person or another man's name. He speaks with the authority which belongs to God, his Father, God and God alone. Jesus told the man to do what he could not do. Being paralyzed, it was impossible for him to rise or to take up his bed and walk. For 38 years, this man have never stood on his own two feet. But at the power of the words of the Lord Jesus, at this moment, at this season, at this time in this man's life, after 38 years, Jesus challenged the man to believe him for the impossible. I want to say to you that the Lord Jesus wants to challenge you to believe him for the impossible. This man was being carried by his bed, and at the command of the Lord Jesus, now he could carry his bed. This happened as this man responded in faith to believe Jesus for the impossible, and he did exactly what Jesus told him to do. And even though for a moment it seemed that it was impossible to do it, The fact that he was healed confirmed that he put his faith in the Lord Jesus, and he was willing to do exactly what Jesus told him to do. I want to declare to you, and I want to ask you, and I want to encourage you, are you willing to put your faith in the power of the Lord Jesus Christ, in the power of his words? And are you willing to do exactly what the Lord Jesus is saying to you to do? I'm saying to you, if you put your faith, your unwavering confidence in the Lord Jesus, and you do exactly what Jesus tells you to do today, then you're going to have a divine encounter in your situation. Is going to turn around. Do you want Jesus to heal those parts of your life where you've been hurt? Or is it easier for you to hold on to your hurt? What does your mat represent? It might represent maybe relational issues, spiritual issues, emotional paralysis, financial paralysis. I want to encourage you to give it to the Lord Jesus Christ. When your prayer seems to be unanswered, God hasn't forgotten you. When days turn to years and little seems to change, God hasn't forgotten you. The Bible tells us in Psalms 105 and verse 8, he had remembered his covenant forever, the word which he commanded to 1,000 generations. I want to encourage you as I get ready to close to remember what happened here, that Jesus recognized the man, he reached out to the man, amen, and he restored the man. What Jesus did for this man, he will do for you. This man had a divine encounter, and I see in this man many people today that might be listening or viewing, where our lives are sick, we might be fed up, we might feel forgotten, we might feel as though all is gone. There's paralysis in our life, dysfunctionality, and you may have never considered that God might want to do something new. You might not have considered that today is a new day. I want to declare that today is a new day. You know, Sunday is already the 8th day. It's the first day of a new week. But yesterday was the 7th day, Saturday. But Sunday is the 8th day. And the number 8 in scripture is the number of a new beginning. And this, sometimes you may never consider, because you've been so long in a particular situation, so bind up and in paralysis, as it were, in your mind or in your spirit, that you never take time to consider that God is about to do something new for you. Sometimes you wonder if there's more to your life, if there's more to what's happening with you. And sometimes we can become so satisfied and complacent by just getting by, but I've come to tell you, don't give up praying. Don't give up believing. Don't give up on following God. Hallelujah. God does what he does in his time, in his season. And I want to declare that your time and your season has come for a divine encounter. When all else has failed, you need to look up and trust God for a spiritual experience. I want to declare to you today that you are in line for a blessing. Just like this man, you are in line for a promotion. You are in line for an increase. You are in line for a breakthrough. I want to declare that you are in line for a miracle from Almighty God. You are in line for a divine encounter. What God did for this man, when he felt all hope was gone, his time and his season came. Jesus, as I get ready to close, recognizes you. He reaches out to you in his mercy, and he has the power to restore you. If you do what this man did, put your faith in Jesus and do exactly what he says, God Almighty will cause a divine encounter to come into your life. I declare that your time has come, your season has come. This is your hour. This is your day for miracles and for breakthrough. What God did for this man, he will do it for you. And I want to believe God, and I want to challenge you to trust God for divine encounters. Because when all human powers have failed and systems, we need a divine encounter. I want to pray with you. I want to believe God for a breakthrough and a divine encounter in your life. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, we thank you for your word. We thank you for what our ears have heard and our eyes have seen today. Lord, we thank you for what you did for this man. When he least expected it, Lord, you showed up. We thank you that you recognized him, you reached out to him, and you restored his life. Lord, I pray for those that are listening and viewing today. We are believing you for divine encounters in the midst of our crisis, in the midst. I pray for those who feel forgotten, those who feel overtaken, overpassed, Lord, that you don't love them, you don't care for them, Father. I pray that you will reveal your love and your power to someone who is viewing today. I pray that you will strengthen and edify those who believe and cause them to grow in their faith and today and to do exactly what you're saying. Those who might have fallen away from you, Lord Jesus, I pray that you will heal the backsliders and bring them back into right relationship with you. Those who don't know you as their personal Lord and Master, we claim souls. We claim a harvest of souls in the name of Jesus Christ. I declare and I prophesy over you supernatural breakthroughs. I declare the manifestation of God's power and purpose in your life today. I command sick folks to be healed. We come against all kinds of paralysis, spiritual paralysis, Lord. We pray for healing and miracles against emotional paralysis, financial paralysis, oh God. We command sick folks to be healed today in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I declare, oh God, a new season has come for somebody today. I declare, oh God, promotion and increase in the name of Jesus. I declare and I release the multiplication anointing upon some life. For you anoint our head with oil, our cup runneth over. Father, we thank you for the word today. We declare just as you changed that man's life that day, we declare today to be a new day, a new hour, and a new time in our life. And we declare we shall never be the same again according to your power and your grace. For we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen and amen and amen and amen. I want to encourage you to keep your faith alive and do exactly what the Lord Jesus said. And if you do, God by his divine power will work a miracle in your life. Just as promised, we want to go into communion, but before we do, we have a special song by a young lady from our church. She's a great blessing with a powerful and anointed voice, Sister Nisi Henry. And she's going to come and she's going to minister to you in song. And then I want to encourage you as you listen and receive to get yourselves together and your family, for we want to go into Holy Communion at this time. So receive this ministry and we'll come back to you shortly in Jesus' name.
Save my life, yes.
Amen, amen. I hope you enjoy that ministry. Sister Nisi, we thank you for ministry in song. She's a very powerful young lady, a great blessing to our church, and she sings and she ministers all over. And I really trust that you would have received an encouragement today concerning the power of the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so I want to invite you, you're a born-again Christian, a born-again child of God, living the overcoming life, and you belong to the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord Jesus, in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, the Apostle Paul, writing to the church in Corinth, is an institution of the Lord. We want to encourage you to, as I would have mentioned to you earlier, to get your bread or your crackers or your Crix or your grape juice, cranberry juice, whatever you have, as we want to lift it to the Lord. The Apostle Paul, writing to the church in Corinth, in 1 Corinthians 11, he says, "For I receive from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.' For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Therefore, whoever eats this bread and drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this reason, many are sick and weak and sick, sorry, among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we would not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened by the Lord, that we may not be condemned with the world. Therefore, brethren, when you come together to eat, wait for one another. But if anyone is hungry, let him eat at home, lest you come together for judgment, and the rest I will set in order when I come." I want to encourage you to really examine your life before the Lord. The Bible encourages us to partake of the Lord's table, and the apostle challenges us to examine ourselves. And so I really want to encourage you to examine yourselves as we commit this prayer. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to obey your instructions, to follow this institution that you've given to the church. And so as we lift our lives, those that are viewing and listening, Father, we pray as you search us and you know us. We repent before you. We ask for your mercy. We ask for your forgiveness. We ask for cleansing in our hearts and our lives of those things which are not of you, those things that will hinder us, Lord, from partaking worthily. We seek your mercy, your forgiveness, and your deliverance. And we pray for our cleansing with your precious blood, as we ask you to bless, oh God, this time of fellowship with you and with each other. In Jesus' name, we pray with thanksgiving. Amen and amen and amen. And so the Lord's table is an institution that the Lord instituted, and encouraged the disciples to follow this institution. One, to remember Calvary, to remember what the Lord Jesus did for us through his death, burial, and his resurrection. It's a time for us to fellowship with God, to fellowship with each other. And not only do we remember what the Lord did and our fellowship with each other, but this, the purpose of this, as we eat this bread and drink the cup of the Lord, the Bible says we proclaim his death till he comes. So we look with anticipation for the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. So I want to encourage you to get your peace, as you want to lift the symbol of the body of the Lord Jesus Christ, which was broken for us. And I want to bless it, and I want you to lift it before the Lord wherever you are. Let's pray and bless it and give thanks. Father, we thank you as we lift this emblem, the symbol of your body. We thank you for the sacrifice. We thank you for the stripes you received on your back. For with your stripes, Lord, we are healed. And so we lift this emblem today. We bless it. We sanctify it. We pray for understanding and you strengthen our faith. As we partake today, Father, we partake in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit with thanksgiving. Amen and amen and amen. I want to encourage you, as we heed the words of the Lord Jesus after he broke it, he said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's partake together. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Give him thanks even as you partake, as you remember his broken body and the sacrifice that Jesus made for you And if you're sick in your body, whatever sickness or paralysis, just like our friend that we spoke about at the pool of Bethesda, I want you to believe God for a healing miracle, because with his stripes, we are healed. The Bible says, in the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so the blood of Jesus is symbolic for our cleansing. Jesus' blood was shed for the cleansing of our sins. There is life and there is cleansing in the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. I want you to lift the symbol of his blood. Let's bless it and give thanks, and then we partake together. Father, we lift the emblem of your blood. We thank you that the blood of Jesus Christ, your Son, cleanses us from every sin. And today we declare that we will not redeem with corruptible things as silver and as gold, but with the precious blood of Jesus, Alam without blemish and without spot. We pray today, as we partake by faith, that you'll bring fresh cleansing, fresh strength, and fresh life, God, into our spirit, our souls, and our body. We bless the emblem, we thank you, and we give you the glory in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit with thanksgiving. Amen, and amen, and amen. Let's drink together in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, amen. I trust God that you feel strengthened, you feel encouraged, you feel healed. And so we want to thank you as always for viewing and for fellowshipping with us. Before we bring it to a close and we share the information on our website and our Facebook, we thank you for joining us today. We trust that you've been blessed and encouraged. We want to extend a special happy birthday to the head of our band or music ministry at our church, Brother Kevin Antoine. Today is his birthday. And so, Kevin, we want to wish you a happy and a blessed birthday. We thank God for what he has done for you, what he's doing in you, through you, and even for what he is about to do. We declare that surely goodness and mercy will follow you all the days of your life. May you live to see many more birthdays, and may you fulfill. So I want to encourage you and join with us at our church, our band leader, Brother Kevin Antoine, as he celebrates his birthday on this very beautiful day. God bless you. We thank you for viewing. Feel free to contact us. There are numbers there. Names of persons, our website information, our Facebook, and we're looking forward to seeing you soon. God bless you in Jesus' name.